What's up, everyone, and welcome to this week's Cybersecurity Weekly. I have been programmed to help you reflect on the important cybersecurity events of the last week. Check out the description below for individual time markers and jump around to any story you want. If you find my work valuable, of course, I ask you to hit the like button and share this episode with anyone you know who can benefit from this information. And lastly, if you've not already, please also consider subscribing to my channel.
Oh, drat these computers. They're so naughty and so complex. I could pinch them.
We start off today with phishing. The phishing-as-a-service, or FAS, platform, Robin Banks, was originally hosted by Cloudflare. But the company, meaning Cloudflare, in July, disassociated Robin Banks' phishing infrastructure from its services after being informed. The move caused a multi-day disruption to FAS operations. Then the administrators of the platform made several changes, including migration of the infrastructure to the notorious Russian bulletproof hosting provider. According to the popular investigator Brian Krebs, DDoS Guard also hosted content for conspiracy theory movements QAnon and 8chan, as well as the official site for the Hamas terrorist group. The provider never complies with takedown requests issued by law enforcement agencies, hence bulletproof. Experts from cybersecurity company IronNet pointed out that operators behind the Robin Banks also added a new cookie-stealing feature that can be purchased by their customers as an add-on to the phishing kit. This feature allows crooks to order this feature to bypass multi-factor authentication in their campaigns. This feature is offered for $1,500 per month, while Robin Banks' full access is offered for $200 per month. The Robin Banks was first analyzed in July 2022. It relies heavily on open source code and off-the-shelf tooling. In addition to migrating its infrastructure to DDoS Guard, Robin Banks also started enforcing increased security on the platform, most likely out of fear someone might hack their admin interface. This included implementing and requiring two-factor authentication in order for kit customers to view phished information via the main GUI, reads a report published by security firm IronNet. However, if they did not want to implement two-factor authentication, the customers could instead opt to have the phished information sent to a Telegram bot rather than access it through the Robin Banks GUI. The experts observed three common phishlets that are included in the distribution: Google, Yahoo, and Outlook. Phishlets are the configuration files for proxying a legitimate website into a phishing site and are essentially used by the evil GINX2 phishing kit. Once the researchers have deobfuscated the core of the phishing kit, the experts discover that it borrows code from a third-party ad fraud detection service named AdSpect. AdSpect allows to detect and filter unwanted visitors in web traffic through blacklisting, fingerprinting, and machine learning techniques. Robin Banks' heavily reliance on open-source code and off-the-shelf tooling showcases just how low the barrier to entry is to not only conduct phishing attacks, but also to becoming a service provider and creating a fast platform for others to use. It does not take a high sophistication level to create a kit such as this and change hundreds of thousands of dollars or charge of dollars to others to use it, concludes the post. Thus, the growing use of different web tools to host cybercriminal platforms poses concerns as cybercrime becomes more accessible and a low-effort option to drawing in a quick profit. Microsoft's Dynamics 365 customer voice product allows organizations to gain customer feedback. It is used to conduct customer satisfaction surveys. Researchers from cybersecurity firm Avanon uncovered a campaign abusing Microsoft Dynamics 365 customer voice to steal credentials from the victims. The experts reported hundreds of these attacks in the last few weeks. The emails come from the survey feature in the Dynamics 365. The sender's address includes Forms Pro, which is the old name of the survey feature. The message informs the recipient that a new voicemail has been received. Upon clicking on the Play Voicemail button, the recipient is redirected to a phishing link that points to a page that clones the Microsoft login page. Hackers continually use what we call the static expressway to reach end users. In short, it's a technique that leverages legitimate sites to get past security scanners. The logic is this: security services can't outright block Microsoft. It would be impossible to get any work done. Instead, these links from trusted sources tend to be automatically trusted. That has created an avenue for hackers to insert themselves, reads the post published by Avanon. We now move on to patches. Apple released out-of-band patches for iOS and macOS to address two code execution flaws, tracked as CVE-2022-40303 and CVE-2022-40304, in the libxml2 library for parsing XML documents. The two vulnerabilities were discovered by Google Project Zero security researchers. A remote attacker can trigger the vulnerabilities to cause unexpected app termination or arbitrary code execution. The CVE-2022-40303 flaw is an integer overflow that was addressed through improved input validation. The issue was discovered by Maddie Stone of Google Project Zero. The CVE-2022-40304 flaw was discovered by Ned Williamson and Nathan Wachholz of Google Project Zero. Apple addressed it with improved checks. When an entity reference cycle is detected, the entity content is cleared by setting its first byte to zero, but the entity content might be allocated from a dictionary. In this case, the dictionary entry becomes corrupted, leading to all kinds of logic errors, including memory errors like double freeze, reads the description for this issue. Microsoft Patch Tuesday updates for November 2022 addressed 64 new vulnerabilities in Microsoft Windows and Windows components, Azure and Azure Real-Time Operating System, Microsoft Dynamics, Exchange Server, Office and Office Components, Internals, Visual Studio, SharePoint Server, Network Policy Servers, Windows BitLocker, and Linux Kernel and Open Source Software. 11 vulnerabilities are rated as critical, and 53 are rated important in severity. This month, Microsoft addressed a couple of vulnerabilities in MS Exchange that are currently being exploited in the wild. They were expected last month, but they are finally here, along with several other Exchange fixes. These bugs were purchased by the ZDI at the beginning of September and reported to Microsoft at the time. At some point later, they were detected in the wild. Microsoft has released several different mitigation recommendations, but the best advice is to test and deploy these fixes, reads the announcements published by ZDI. There were some who doubted these patches would release this month, so it's good to see they were. The following vulnerabilities are actively exploited. CVE-2022-41028, Microsoft Exchange Server Remote Code Execution Vulnerability. CVE-2022-41040, Microsoft Exchange Server Elevation of Privilege Vulnerability. CVE-2022-41128, Windows Scripting Languages Remote Code Execution Vulnerability. CVE-2022-41091, Windows Mark of the Web Security Feature Bypass Vulnerability. CVE-2022-41073, Windows Print Spooler Elevation of Privilege Vulnerability. And CVE-2022-41125, Windows CNG Key Isolation Service Elevation of Privilege Vulnerability. These vulnerabilities affect Exchange Server. Exchange Online customers are already protected from the vulnerabilities addressed in these SUs and do not need to take any action other than updating any Exchange service in their environment, reads the advisory published by Microsoft. Mitigations are not actual code fixes or specific vulnerabilities. Please install the November 2022 or later SU on your Exchange service to address the CVE-2022-41040 and CVE-2022-41082. Says Microsoft. VMware has released security updates to address three critical vulnerabilities impacting the Workspace ONE Assist product. Remote attackers can exploit the vulnerability to bypass authentication and elevate privileges to admin. Workspace ONE Assist allows IT staff to remotely access and troubleshoot devices in real time from the Workspace ONE console. The first issue tracked to CVE-2022-3168 with the CVSS version 3 score of 9.8 out of 10 is an authentication bypass flaw. An attacker with network access to Workspace ONE Assist may be able to obtain administrative access without the need to authenticate to the application. The second issue tracked to CVE-2022-31686 with the CVSS version 3 score of 9.8 out of 10 is a broken authentication method. An attacker with network access may be able to obtain administrative access without the need to authenticate to the application. The third critical issue, fixed by the virtualization giant, is a broken authentication control track to CVE-2022-31687. An attacker with network access may be able to obtain administrative access without the need to authenticate to the application. The company addressed them with the release of Workspace ONE Assist 22.10.89993 for Windows customers. Google has addressed a high-severity security bug tracked as CVE-2022-20465, affecting all Pixel smartphones that could be exploited to unlock the devices. The Google Pixel lock screen bypass was reported by security researcher David Schutz that was awarded $70,000 for this flaw. The issue allowed an attacker with physical access to bypass the lock screen protections, fingerprint, PIN, etc., and gain complete access to the user's device. The vulnerabilities track to CVE-2022-20465, and it might affect other Android vendors as well. Reads a post published by Schutz. You can find my patch advisory in the raw bug report I have sent to Google at feed.bugs.blah blah David, whoever. The expert discovered how to unlock a Pixel phone using a PIN locked SIM card and knowing its PUK code. That sounds kind of complex. He reported the vulnerability in June 2022, and Google fixed it in the release of Android update for November 2022. Schutz noticed a strange behavior of his mobile device during a journey and started looking at it again the next day. After rebooting the phone, putting in the incorrect PIN three times, entering the PUK, and using a new PIN, he noticed that the device went to the Pixel is starting state. Since the attack could just bring his or her own PIN-locked SIM card, nothing other than physical access was required for exploitation, Schutz explained. The attacker could just swap the SIM in the victim's device and perform the exploit with a SIM card that had a PIN lock and for which the attacker knew the correct PUK code. But if you look around the streets, just try to get somebody's phone out of their hand. Good luck with that. The expert analyzed source code commits that address the flaw since Android is open source. He discovered that the fix has a huge impact on the overall source code. He noticed that many files have been changed. Hey, we now move on to attacks, vulnerabilities, and updates. A threat actor, 0x_dump, claims to have hacked the multinational investment bank Deutsche Bank and is offering access to its network for sale online. The security researcher Dominic Alvieri was one of the first experts to report the announcement published by the initial access broker on Telegram. The IAB claims to have access to around 21,000 machines in the bank's network, most of which are Windows systems. It also claims that the compromised machines were protected with a semantic EDR solution. FTP shells, root SQL injection, DB servers, we're selling another network access to a particular bank. Internal network, we have DA, domain has around 21,000 machines configured, most being Windows EDR of machines are semantic. Also, internal network filters, TCP, UDP, HTTP, and HTTPS. Employees communicate between office chat services. There is file servers with more than 16 terabytes of internal data, including share folder for every user on the network. And they also have FlexCube DB. We can provide VDI and VPN plus all passwords of domain dump with DA users. Their funds is in the billions, price 7.5 Bitcoin. We will request for proof that one can afford to avoid time wasters, reads the announcement. The seller said that said to have had access to chat services used for the internal communications. He also claimed to have access to file servers containing 16 terabytes of data, which I just read to you. The IAB is offering access to the Deutsche Bank for 7.5 Bitcoin, worth approximately $156,274. The seller added that he is receiving a lot of requests for this offer. We're getting a lot of requests, and it's hard to filter out fake buyers, so we ask for proof you can afford it or share with us your forums. We recommend we'll known individuals for us to work easily, added the seller. Researchers from mobile security firm Lookout uncovered two long-running surveillance campaigns targeting the Uyghurs minority. The threat actors behind the campaigns used two Android spyware to spy on the victims and steal sensitive information. The campaigns involved a new piece of malware called BadBazaar and new variants of the MOONSHINE surveillance software discovered by Citizen Lab in 2019 and employed in attacks against Tibetan activists. The investigation into the BadBazaar campaign started in late 2021 and is based on a tweet from @MalwareHunterTeam, research team that was referencing a malicious English Uyghur dictionary app. The malicious app was connected to surveillance campaigns targeting Uyghurs and other Turkic ethnic minorities in China and abroad. The researchers attribute the campaigns to the China-linked APT 15 cyber espionage group, aka Nickel, aka K3 Chang, aka Mirage, Vixen Panda, Royal APT, and Playful Dragon. APT 15 has been active since at least 2010. It conducted cyber espionage campaigns against targets worldwide in several industries, including defense, high-tech, energy, government, aerospace, and manufacturing. Since 2010, the attackers demonstrated an increasing level of sophistication across the years. They used custom malware and various exploits in their attacks. The BadBazaar campaign dates back to late 2018. Over the time, the researchers obtained 111 unique apps that masquerade as harmless apps such as radio apps, messaging apps, dictionaries, religious apps, and even TikTok. Overlapping infrastructure and TTPs indicate these campaigns are connected to APT 15, a Chinese-backed hacking group that also is known as Vixen Panda and Nickel. We named this malware family BadBazaar in response to an early variant that posed as a third-party app store titled APK Bazaar. Bazaar is a lesser-known spelling of bazaar, reads the report published by Lookout. Lookout researchers also discovered a benign app on the Apple's App Store that communicates with the same command and control infrastructure used by the Android BadBazaar variants. The iOS app collects basic iPhone device information, and it has an identical name of Uyghur lug hat and icon. The discovery of an iOS app suggests that the threat actors are likely planning to update their malware, developing an iOS version that includes surveillance capabilities. The rate at which new samples are deployed indicates these campaigns are ongoing. The majority of these samples are Trojanized versions of popular social media platforms like WhatsApp or Telegram, or Trojanized versions of Muslim cultural apps, Uyghur language tools, or prayer apps, continues the report. Our moonshine samples were acquired from multiple Uyghur language communication channels, some boasting hundreds of members. Experts discovered that on all moonshine samples connect to administrator panels similar to the ones analyzed by citizen lab researchers in 2019. The Lookout's report demonstrates that Chinese threat actors continue to target Uyghur and Muslim mobile device users through Uyghur language communications platforms. The wide distribution of both BadBazaar and Moonshine, and the rate at which new functionality has been introduced, indicate the development of these families is ongoing and that there is a continued demand for these tools, concludes the report. In mid-October, Microsoft Threat Intelligence Center, or MSTIC, researchers uncovered previously undetected ransomware tracked as Prestige ransomware employed in attacks targeting organizations in the transportation and related logistics industries in the Ukraine and Poland. The Prestige ransomware first appeared in the threat landscape on October 11th in attacks occurring within an hour of each other across all victims. A notable feature of this campaign is that it is uncommon to observe the threat actors attempting to deploy ransomware into the networks of Ukrainian enterprises. The campaign shares victimology with recent operations conducted by Russia-linked threat actors. In an update provided by Microsoft this week, MSTIC attributes the campaign to the IRIDIUM, aka Sandworm, as cyber espionage group. Sandworm has been active since 2000. We just had 2010, now we have 2000. That's 22 years. It operates under the control of Unit 74455 of the Russian GRU's main center for special technologies. The group is also the author of the NotPetya ransomware that hit hundreds of companies worldwide in June 2017, causing billions worth of damage. In April, Sandworm targeted energy facilities in Ukraine with a new strain of the Destroyer ICS malware in Destroyer 2 and a new version of the CaddyWiper wiper. The APT hacking group is believed to have been behind numerous attacks this year, including an attack on Ukrainian energy infrastructure and the deployment of a persistent botnet called Cyclops Blink, dismantled by the U.S. government in April. From August 2022, recorded future researchers observed a rise in command and control infrastructure used by Sandworm, tracked by Ukraine's CERT UA as UIC0113. The researchers observed command and control infrastructure relying on dynamic DNS domains masquerading as Ukrainian telecommunications service providers. Microsoft's attribution to Iridium is based on forensic artifacts, as well as overlaps in victimology, TTPs, and infrastructure with the Russia-linked app group. Researchers from industrial security firm Clarity disclosed details of a vulnerability affecting ABB Totalflow flow computers and remote controllers. Flow computers are used to calculate volume and flow rates for oil and gas that are critical to electric power manufacturing and distribution. The critical systems are widely used by oil and gas organizations worldwide. The vulnerability CVE-2022-0902 with a CVSS score of 8.1 is a path traversal issue that can be exploited by an attacker to inject and execute arbitrary code. According to Clarity experts, the vulnerability resides in the implementation of the Totalflow TCP protocol in ABB G5 products. Team 82 found a high severity path traversal vulnerability, CVE-2022-0902, in ABB's Totalflow flow computers and remote controllers. Attackers can exploit this flaw to gain root access on an ABB flow computer, read and write files, and remotely execute code. So, I don't know if it's unauthenticated or authenticated or need to be local, but it says remotely executed code, which indicates to me that this can be remotely done. And that's according to the advisory published by Clarity. The industrial and automation giant ABB addressed the flaw in the release of firmware updates on July 14th, 2022. So if you haven't already install them. The researchers initially discovered an authentication bypass issue, then explored the systems looking at functionalities available to authenticated users, such as uploading and downloading configuration files. We chose the simplest approach, reading /etc/shadow, and using hashcat cracking the root account password, which turned out to be a root. Then we changed the SSH configuration file to enable root to connect using password. Then all that was left to do was to turn on the SSH daemon using the Totalflow protocol and connect to it, concludes the advisory. A successful exploit of this issue could impede a company's ability to bill customers, forcing a disruption of services, similar to the consequences suffered by Colonial Pipeline following its 2021 ransomware attack. Mondiant researchers in early 2022 responded to an incident where the Russia-linked APT29 group, aka SVR group, or Cozy Bear, or Nobelium, or the Dukes, successfully phished a European diplomatic entity. The attack stands out for the use of the Windows credential roaming feature. Credential roaming was introduced by Microsoft in Windows Server 2003 SP1 and is still supported in Windows 11 and Windows Server 2022. The feature is used to roam certificates and other credentials with the user within a domain. APT29, along with APT28, Cyber Espionage Group, was involved in a Democratic National Committee hack and the wave of attacks aimed at the 2016 U.S. presidential elections. In the attack analyzed by Mondiant, the experts observed numerous LDAP queries with atypical properties performed against the Active Directory system. The queried LDAP attributes relate to usual credential information gathering, e.g. Unix user password. However, one attribute in particular stood out. This B7FF5A blah blah blah, or MSPKI credential roaming tokens, which is described by Microsoft as storage of encrypted user credential token blobs for roaming, reads the post published by Mondiant. Upon further inspection, Mondiant identified that this attribute is part of a lesser-known feature of Active Directory, credential roaming. The researchers discovered an arbitrary file write vulnerability. An attacker can exploit the issue to control the MSPKI account credentials LDAP attribute and add a malicious roaming token entry where the identifier string contains directory traversal characters. Then the attacker can write an arbitrary number of bytes to any file in the file system, posing as the victim account. The report pointed out that the full file name plus directory traversal characters fits within the 92 bytes buffer. Successful exploitation of the flaw can allow the attackers to achieve remote code execution in the context of the logged-in user. Mondiant reported the flaw to MSRC in April 2022. The issue, tracked to CVE-2022-30170, was addressed by the IT giant on September 13th. The use of credential roaming allows attackers to abuse the saved credentials to escalate privileges below some attack scenarios that see attackers to abuse credential roaming. An organization has not applied the September 22 patch to each system where credential roaming is used. An attacker gained domain administrative privileges in an organization where credential roaming is in use or was used in the past without proper cleanup. An attacker has access to the clear text password of a user where credential roaming is in use or was in use in the past. An attacker has read access to the MSPKI PAPI master keys attribute on a victim account, but does not have the clear text password of the victim user. Lenovo has released security updates to address a couple of high severity vulnerabilities impacting various ThinkBook, IdeaPad, and Yoga laptop models. An attacker can exploit the flaws to disable UEFI security boot. Secure boot is a security feature of the latest unified extensible firmware interface 2.3.1 designed to detect tampering with bootloaders, key operating system files, and unauthorized option ROMs by validating their digital signatures. Detections are blocked from running before they can attack or infect the system specification. An attacker that is able to bypass the secure boot could bypass any security measure running on the machine and achieve persistence even in case the operating system is reinstalled. The root access of the flaw is the use of a vulnerable driver during the manufacturing process for some Lenovo devices that was mistakenly not deactivated. While disabling UEFI secure boot allows direct execution of unsigned UEFI apps, restoring factory default DBX enables the use of known vulnerable bootloaders, which is CVE-2022-34301, found by Eclipsium, to bypass secure boot while keeping it enabled, reads one of the tweets published by ESET. Owners of the affected devices are highly recommended to update to the latest firmware version. Visiting Lenovo address advisory, it is possible to determine if a device is affected by these vulnerabilities and receive firmware updates instructions. Google Project Zero disclosed three Samsung phone vulnerabilities tracked to CVE-2021-25337, CVE-2021-25369, and CVE-2021-25370 that have been exploited by a surveillance company. The three issues are CVE-2021-25337, improper access control in clipboard service in Samsung mobile devices prior to SMR March 2021 release. One allows untrusted applications to read or write certain local files. CVE-2021-25369, an improper access control vulnerability in sec_log file prior to SMR March 2021 release. One exposes sensitive kernel information to user space. CVE-2021-25370, an incorrect implementation handling file descriptor in DPU driver prior to SMR March 2021 release 1, results in memory corruption leading to kernel panic. The researchers pointed out that the surveillance firm included in its spyware the exploits for these three vulnerabilities that were 0-day at the time of their exploitation. This in-the-wild exploit chain is a great example of different attack surfaces and shape than many of the Android exploits we've seen in the past. All three vulnerabilities in this chain were in the manufacturer's custom components rather than in the AOSP platform or the Linux kernel, reads the advisory published by Google Project Zero. It's also interesting to note that two out of the three vulnerabilities were logic and design vulnerabilities rather than memory safety. The tag team only obtained a partial exploit chain for Samsung phones that were likely in the testing phase. The experts revealed that the sample is dated back to late 2020. The chain merited further analysis because it is a three vulnerability chain where all three vulnerabilities are within Samsung custom components, including a vulnerability in a Java component, reported the advisory. The experts explained that the exploit sample targets Samsung phones running kernel 4.14.113 with the Exynos SoC. This specific SoC is used by phones sold in the Europe or in Europe and Africa. The exploit relies on both the Mali GPU driver and the DPU driver, which are specific to the Exynos Samsung phones. Samsung phones that were running kernel 4.14.113 0.113 in late 2020 include the S10, A50, and A51. Google reported the vulnerabilities to Samsung immediately after their discovery in late 2020, and the vendor addressed them in March 2021. Google did not reveal the name of the surveillance vendor. It only highlighted similarities with other campaigns that target Android users in Italy and Kazakhstan. Labeling when vulnerabilities are known to be exploited in the wild is important both for targeted users and for the security industry. When in the wild, 0 days are not transparently disclosed, we are not able to use that information to further protect users using patch analysis and variant analysis to gain and understand an understanding of what attackers already know, concludes the report. The analysis of this exploit chain has provided us with new and important insights into how attackers are targeting Android devices. It highlights a need for more research into manufacturer-specific components. Checkpoint researchers discovered a malicious package named Apicolor on the Python package index PyPI that uses steganographic to hide malware within image files. The malicious package infects PyPI users through open source projects on GitHub. The analysis of the package installation script revealed a code section of the beginning. It starts by manually installing extra requirements, then it downloads an image, 8f4d2uf.png, hosted on Imgur, and uses the newly installed package called judeb to process the picture and trigger the processing generated output using the execute command. The two packages being manually installed are requests, quite popular helper package for API usage, and judeb. The judeb package details initially seem like an in-progress package, having an empty description and a vague header stating this is a pure Python judeb module, reads the analysis published by Checkpoint. A deeper look revealed judeb was first released around the same time as Apicolor. The judeb code turned out to be a steganography module responsible for hiding and revealing hidden messages inside pictures. Checkpoint researchers suspected that the image downloaded during the Apicolor installation may include a hidden part inside of it. The judeb package was used to extract obfuscated Python code hidden in the image. Once decoded, it retrieves and executes a malicious binary from a remote server. The experts searched for code projects using the above packages and discovered that API caller and judeb have low usage on GitHub projects. Experts recommend to consider only open source projects with a reputation, taking care of the positive feedback and the number of forks. One of the projects analyzed by the researchers, despite fitting with this criteria, had dozens of stars and hundreds of forks that were synthetically generated. The experts noticed only a single forking account and a set of starring accounts that were used to provide positive feedback to the project as part of the malicious campaign. Researchers from ANLAB Security Emergency Response Center reported that the Amadei malware is being used to deploy Lockbit 3.0 ransomware on compromised systems, researchers have warned. Amadei Bot is a data-stealing malware that was first spotted in 2018. It also allows operators to install additional payloads. The malware is available for sale in illegal forms. In the past, it was used by cybercrime gangs like TA-505 to install Gand Crab ransomware or flawed Emmy Rat. In July, ASEC researchers discovered that Amadei malware was being distributed by Smoke Loader, which was hidden in software cracks and serial generation programs available on multiple sites. The ASIC analysis team has confirmed that attackers are using Amadei Bot to install Lockbit, reads the report published by the security firm. Amadei Bot, the malware that is used to install Lockbit, is being distributed through two methods, one using a malicious Word document file, and the other using an executable that takes the disguise of the Word file icon. The researchers provided details about two recent distribution cases. In the first distribution scenario, threat actors used a malicious Word document named sia_sim.docx. It downloads a Word file that contains a malicious VBA macro. The text body includes an image that prompts the user to click Enable Content to enable the VBA macro. The text body contains an image that prompts the user to click Enable Content to enable the VBA macro, which in turn runs a PowerShell command to download and run Amadei. The malicious Microsoft Word document was uploaded to VirusTotal on October 28, 2022. In a second distribution case, threat actors disguise the Amadei malware as a seemingly harmless file bearing a Word icon, but is actually an executable, resume.exe. The file is distributed via phishing messages, but at this time, ASIC has yet to identify the email used as a lure. Once installed, Amadei registers to the task scheduler to gain persistence. It connects to the command and control server, sends default information of the infected system, and receives commands. Experts notice that Amadei receives three commands from the command and control server. These commands are used to download and execute malware from an external source. Two commands, cc.ps1, which is a PowerShell script, and dd.ps1, which is also a PowerShell script, are lock bits in PowerShell form, while a third one, named lbb.exe, is lock bit in exe form. Lockbits are installed via Amadei, have been distributed in Korea since 2022, and the team has posted various articles that analyze the ransomware. The recently confirmed version is Lockbit 3.0, which is distributed using keywords such as job application and copyright. Judging from the themes, it appears that the attack is targeting companies, concludes the report. As Lockbit ransomware is being distributed through various methods, user caution is advised. Users should update the applications and version 3. They use the latest version and refrain from opening document files from unknown sources. Cyber researchers uncovered a smoke loader campaign that is distributing community malware such as SystemBC and Raccoon Stealer 2.0, along with a new Clipper malware tracked as Lapless. The experts detected more than 180 different samples of the Clipper malware in the last 2 weeks, a circumstance that confirms that the threat has been widely deployed in recent weeks. Clipper is a family of malware designed to hijack cryptocurrency transactions by swapping the victim's wallet address with the wallet address owned by attackers. Clipper malware monitors the clipboard of the victim's system. Then, whenever the user copies data, it verifies if it is a valid cryptocurrency wallet address and replaces it with the attacker's wallet address. Lapless is new Clipper malware that generates a wallet address similar to the victim's wallet address. The victim will not notice the difference in the address, which significantly increases the chances of successfully Clipper activity. Lapless uses a trick to avoid detection. It generates a wallet address similar to the victim's wallet address. Lapless is this new Clipper malware that generates a wallet address similar to the victim's wallet address, which I just said. The victim will not notice the difference in the address, which I just said, which significantly increases the chances of successful Clipper activity, which I just said. This Clipper can target multiple wallets, including Bitcoin, Ethereum, Bitcoin Cash, Litecoin, Dogecoin, or Dogecoin, Monero, Ripple, Zcash, Dash, Ronin, Tron, and Steam Trade URL. Smoke Loader is a well-known, highly configurable, effective malware that TAs are actively renovating. It is a modular malware, indicating it can get new execution instructions from command and control servers and download additional malware for expanded functionality. In this case, the TAs use three different malware families for financial gain and other malicious purposes, concludes the report. The Record Breaker, a revived version of Raccoon Stealer, is used to steal sensitive information. The SystemBC is a multifunctional threat combining proxy and remote access Trojan features, and the new Lapless Clipper performs clipboard hijacking to steal cryptocurrency from victims. A threat group tracked as Warrock hides malware within PNG images to infect victims' machines with information-stealing malware about without raising alarms. This has been confirmed by researchers at Avast, who build upon the findings of ESET, the first to spot the and report WarRock's activity in early September 2022. ESET warned that WarRock targeted high-profile victims, including government entities in the Middle East, Southeast Asia, and South Africa, but their visibility into the group's attack chain was limited. Avast report is based on additional artifacts the company captured from WarRock attacks, confirming ESET's assumptions about the nature of the PNG files and adding new information on the type of malware payloads and the data exfiltration method. While the method used to breach networks remains unknown, Avast believes WarRock likely uses DLL sideloading to execute the CLR loader malware loader into memory. This is based on evidence from compromised machines where Avast researchers found four DLLs containing the CLR loader code. Next, the CLR loader loads the second stage DLL, PNG loader, which extracts bytes embedded in PNG files and uses them to assemble two executables. Steganography is concealing code inside image files that appear normal when opened in an image viewer. In the case of WarRock, Avast says the threat actors used a technique called least significant bit encoding, which embeds small chunks of the malicious code in the least important bits of the image's pixels. The first payload extracted from these bits by PNG loader is a PowerShell script that neither ESET nor Avast could retrieve. The second payload hiding in the PNG file is a custom.NET C# info stealer Dropbox control that abuses the Dropbox file hosting service for command and control communication, file exfiltration, and more. Medibank announced that personal data belonging to around 9.7 million of current and former customers were exposed as a result of the recent ransomware attack. Medibank is one of the largest Australian private health insurance providers with approximately 3.9 million customers. The health insurer believes the attackers have not accessed credit card and banking details and primary identity documents such as driver's license because it doesn't collect them except in exceptional circumstances. The company discovered the ransomware attack on October 12th. It also announced that no ransom payment will be made to the threat actors for the data theft. The attackers had access to data belonging to around 5.1 million Medibank customers, around 2.8 million AHM customers, and around 1.8 million international customers. Given the nature of this crime, unfortunately, we now believe that all the customer data accessed could have been taken by the criminal, concludes the data breach notice. The group of threat actors calling themselves Justice Blade published leaked data from SmartLink BPO Solutions, an outsourcing IT vendor working with major enterprises and government agencies in the Kingdom of Saudi Arabia and other countries in the GCC. The bad actors claim to have stolen a significant volume of data, including CRM records, personal information, email communications, contracts, and account credentials. The same day, Justice Blade also set up a Telegram account with a private communications channel. On the screenshots and video leaked by the attackers, the incident could have happened as a result of targeted network intrusion affecting Active Directory and internal applications and services. The bad actors also released screenshots of active RDP sessions and Office 365 communications between various companies from within the region and several lists of users presumably related to FlyNAS, Airlines Company, and SamaCares, which is an initiative managed by Saudi Arabia Central Bank, containing over 100,000 records. According to RE Security Incorporated, protecting major Fortune 500 companies, the data breach may become one of the first meaningful supply chain cybersecurity incidents in the region due to an overlap between an enterprise and the government sector. Threat actors may use the stolen data to target other companies and individuals of interest. RE Security experts mention that multiple leaked credentials belonging to SmartLink BPO Solutions have been previously identified in the dark web and various underground marketplaces in the Tor network, which could be leveraged by the Justice Blade to conduct successful cyber attacks. Based on the currently available data, the announcement of the attack has been initiated with the defacement of a corporate website around November 2nd and progresses a hack and leak operation. Prior to that, on the 30th of October, the activity of Metasploit framework was presumably detected by the victim company, which was deployed by the bad actors post-compromise. According to leaked communications between company staff, the compromised account belonging to an employee was likely used to conduct the attack. Notably, there is no evidence the attack could be financially motivated, as no ransom demands have been registered as of yet. Justice Blade seems to be an ideologically motivated group targeting Saudi Arabia, with published photos of government officials on their website for data leak publication. SmartLink BPO Solutions is a business unit of Al Khalij Training and Education Group. In 2012, Al Khalij Group was listed in Forbes Middle East 2012 as one of the top most powerful 100 companies in the GCC region, it is not yet clear if the incident may be related to the growing tensions between Iran and Saudi Arabia. As reported by the Associated Press, just recently, Saudi Arabia shared intelligence with U.S. officials that suggests Iran could be preparing for an imminent attack on the kingdom. According to multiple sources, law enforcement and federal regulators are investigating the incident to determine the full scope of compromise and the end impact endured. We now move on to other security news. Velasiev is charged with conspiracy to intentionally damage protected computers and to transmit ransom demands. The man could face a maximum of 5 years in prison in case it will be convicted. So, Vasilev allegedly participated in the Lockbit campaign. He is charged with conspiracy to intentionally damage protected computers and to transmit ransom demands. If convicted, again, he faces a maximum of 5 years in prison, reads a press release published by the DOJ. During the October 2022 search of Vasilev's home, Canadian law enforcement discovered a seed phrase for a Bitcoin wallet address. The analysis of the wallet revealed that on or about February 5th, 2022, it received a payment of approximately 0.8057405 Bitcoin, originating from a ransom payment of 2.8759 Bitcoin made around 6 hours earlier by a confirmed Lockbit victim to a wallet address provided by the ransomware conspirators. The U.S. Department of Justice charged Mikhail Vasilev, a dual Russian and Canadian national, for his alleged participation in the Lockbit ransomware operation. According to the press release published by DOJ, the man is currently in custody in Canada and is awaiting extradition to the United States. This arrest is the result of over 2.5 years of investigation into the Lockbit ransomware group, which has harmed victims in the United States and around the world, said Deputy Attorney General Lisa O. Monaco. It is also a result of more than a decade of experience that FBI agents, Justice Department prosecutors, and our international partners have built dismantling cyber threats. Let this be yet another warning to ransomware actors. Working with partners around the world, the Department of Justice will continue to disrupt cyber threats and hold perpetrators to account with a maximum of 5 years in prison. Ooh. With our partners, we will use every available tool to disrupt, deter, and punish cyber criminals. Lockbit targeted at least 1,000 victims worldwide, and the gang earned tens of millions of dollars in actual ransom payments from their victims. The U.S. Department of Justice announced that a man from Georgia, James Zong, has pleaded guilty to wire fraud after stealing more than 50,000 bitcoins from the Silk Road. Zong pled guilty to money laundering crimes. He exploited a flaw in the Silk Road that allowed him to withdraw more Bitcoin than he deposited on the dark web marketplace. The man funded 9 fraudulent accounts with an initial deposit of 200 to 2,000 Bitcoin and then triggered 140 withdrawal transactions in rapid succession. James Zong pled guilty to committing wire fraud in September 2012 when he unlawfully obtained over 50,000 Bitcoin from the Silk Road dark web internet marketplace. Zong pled guilty on Friday, November 4th, 2022, before United States District Judge Paul G. Gardefee, reads the press release published by DOJ. On November 9th, 2021, pursuant to a judiciary authority premises search warrant of Zong's Gainesville, Georgia house, law enforcement seized approximately 50,676.1785897 Bitcoin, then valued over $3.36 billion. The authorities seized the stolen funds on November 2021. At the time, it was the biggest ever seizure of cryptocurrency. The U.S. authorities are seeking to forfeit collectively approximately 51,680 Bitcoin. Law enforcement located this 50,491 Bitcoin of the approximately 53,500 Bitcoin crime proceeds. The funds were stored in an underground floor safe and on a single board computer hidden in Zong's house. The police also recovered 661,900 in cash, 25 Cassius coins, physical Bitcoin, along with 11.1160 blah 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 additional Bitcoin, and 4 1-ounce silver-colored bars, 3 1-ounce gold-colored bars, 4 10-ounce silver-colored bars, and 1 gold-colored coin. In August 2017, Bitcoin split into 2 cryptocurrency, traditional Bitcoin and Bitcoin Cash. At the time, Zong received 50,000 Bitcoin Cash, and the Bitcoin Cash has converted into 3,500 Bitcoins. This means that Zong totaled 53,500 Bitcoin. In March 2022, Zong opted to surrender an additional 825.4 Bitcoins to the authorities, and in May 2022, he provided another 35.5 Bitcoin. James Zong committed wire fraud over a decade ago when he stole approximately 50,000 Bitcoin from Silk Road. For almost 10 years, the whereabouts of this massive chunk of missing Bitcoin had ballooned into an over $3.3 billion mystery, thanks to state-of-the-art cryptocurrency tracing and good old-fashioned police work, law enforcement located and recovered this impressive cache of crime proceeds of the U.S. Attorney Damian Williams. This case shows that we won't stop following the money, no matter how expertly hidden, even to a circuit board in the bottom of a popcorn tin. Zong is scheduled to be sentenced on February 22, 2023 at 3 p.m. Zong, 32, of Gainesville, Georgia, in Athens. That means he was 22 when he did this. Pled guilty to one count of wire fraud, which carries a maximum sentence of 20 years in prison. Ariel Stern, a former Israeli Air Force captain, warns that the U.S. and Israel are still unprepared to defeat a cyber attack against the water sector that could be orchestrated by enemy states like Iran. Stern highlighted the dangers for providers of critical infrastructure and issued his warning following the ransomware attack that in August disrupted IT operations of South Staffordshire Water, a UK company supplying drinking water to 1.6 million consumers daily. The intelligence officer pointed out that the nations like Russia, Iran, North Korea, and China have the capabilities to hit the water sector with dramatic consequences. He flagged that the main advisory in this sphere for Israel is Iran, but cautioned that even after past cyber attacks on Israel's and America's water sector in recent years, we don't have top minds in the water industry, reported the Jerusalem Post. Most water sector workers are civil engineers. How can they ignore cyber dangers? They are very sophisticated within their domain relating to pipes, water flows, ground stabilization, and chemistry, but not with regard to blocking hackers. One of the main problems for the industry is the lack of proper training for cyber defense. A cyber attack against a water facility or an organization in the water sector could have a widespread impact because many infrastructures serve wide areas, including many cities and states, and protecting them is not easy. In many cases, the IT and OT networks are not separated and are not designed to be resilient to cyber attacks. Stern explained that there are 55,000 district water operators in the U.S., but the majority of the population is served by a small number of those operators that are exposed to cyber attacks. He urges these organizations to rapidly adopt necessary defense measures. The story of cybersecurity is decades long. We don't make enough progress over the years for how we secured critical infrastructure of the power plants, water, and other sectors, Biden administration cyber chief N. Neuberger told TGP. Almost immediately after the administration took office, we started drafting the first new cyber executive order. It got released right after the Colonial Pipeline hack, but it was after months of work. President Joe Biden knew the issue. It was clear that cyber was a priority. The U.S. Department of Health and Human Services warned today that Venus ransomware attacks are also targeting the country's healthcare organizations. In an analyst note issued by the Health Sector Cybersecurity Coordination Center, or HC3, HHS security team also mentions that it knows about at least one incident where Venus ransomware was deployed on the networks of a U.S. healthcare organization. However, there is no known data leak site that threat actors deploying Venus ransomware are known to use for publishing stolen data, according to the HC3's report. HC3 is aware of at least one healthcare entity in the United States falling victim to Venus ransomware recently, the report warns. The operators of Venus ransomware are not believed to operate as a ransomware as a service model, and no associated data leak site exists at this time. Venus ransomware was first spotted in mid-August 2022 and has since been deployed across the networks of dozens of corporate victims worldwide. Threat actors behind the Venus ransomware attacks are known for hacking into the victims' publicly exposed remote desktop services to encrypt Windows devices. U.S. federal authorities have warned about other ransomware operations targeting healthcare organizations across the United States this year. Previous alerts include warnings of threat actors deploying Maui and Zeppelin ransomware payloads in attacks against healthcare and public health organizations. A CISA, FBI, and HHS also warned last month that a cybercrime group known as Dykeson Team is targeting the HBH sector in ongoing ransomware attacks. Last but not least, full-service accounts receivables management company Professional Finance Company Incorporated revealed in a data breach notification that a quantum ransomware attack from late February led to a data breach impacting 657 healthcare organizations. However, the attack could have had a much more significant impact since PFC helps thousands of U.S. healthcare, government, and utility organizations to ensure that their customers pay their invoices on time. And that's the news. Thanks again for watching. Don't forget to share and subscribe if you have not already. And smash the bell if you haven't already. And I'll see you on the next episode. Take care.
Don't forget to ride!